Good evening. Thanks for being here tonight. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin today, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for the stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with James Dale and Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings, presented in partnership with Langston and Estelita's Library. We would like to thank author series sponsor Gary Kunis and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Finally, we're grateful to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. First, the wonderful folks at Estelita's Library have copies of We're Better Than This available for sale. You can order through their website, estelitaslibrary.com, and I'll put the link in the chat as well. I also wanted to let you know that toward the end of the conversation, we'll have time for your questions. You can type your questions in the Q&A box that's at the bottom of your screen at any time during the program. Now, I'm delighted to welcome Jasmine Scott, the program director at Langston, who will introduce tonight's program. Hi, Jasmine.
Hey, Stesha, thank you so much. We are so pleased to continue our ongoing partnership with the Seattle Public Library to present amazing literary programs such as this. Langston is a nonprofit organization here in Seattle, Washington, that was conceived and designed by community members to guide generative programs that center Black art, artists, and audiences. Our vision is to cultivate Black brilliance, and our mission is to strengthen and advance our community through Black arts and culture. This evening, we are honored to welcome James Dale and Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings for a conversation about We're Better Than This, the future of our democracy. Part memoir, part call to action, We're Better Than This by Congressman Elijah Cummings is the story of our modern day democracy and the threats that we all must face together, as well as a retrospective on the life lessons, and career of one of our country's most inspirational politicians. Cummings and his collaborator, James Dale, offer us a revealing chronicle of the formative moments in Elijah's life that enabled a child of sharecroppers and preachers to rise to the uppermost levels of government and to eventually take on the daunting task of holding the Trump administration to account. Detailing this moment of unprecedented obstructionism by both the president and his stalwarts, examining the danger posed to democracy itself if the executive branch were allowed to operate above public scrutiny. In the book's final chapter, written by Elijah Cummings' wife, Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings, we are taken through his final days and final messages to us, which turned out to be both painful and vital as we face our greatest test as a nation since the Civil War. We're Better Than This reminds people that in this country, we don't elect kings and that our vote is the most powerful weapon we have. We are so pleased to welcome James Dale and Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings. Welcome, and thank you so much.
Thank you, Jasmine, and thank you, Stesha, and the sponsors for this fabulous event. I must start by saying that Elijah and I loved Seattle. We had one of our most favorite and best trips ever, staying on the Puget Sound and visiting your fair city in the summertime, I might add. and it was quite a beautiful memory for both of us. So there's a special connection there. And the other is that I actually lived in Spokane, Washington. And so, you know, Seattle has been a place that I've visited since my middle school years. So I am very pleased, of course, to be here tonight. This is, of course, a special book talking about a critical time in the history of our nation. And Elijah worked on this book for the last year and a half or so of his life. And it is his legacy piece, something that he intentionally left for our country and for our children. And I should say that, you know, about 8 years before he started working on it, I asked him to actually get the book together because, you know, I felt like he had so many wonderful stories to tell that I wanted him to share them with the world. And frankly, he was sharing them with the world through his speeches, but I thought that they should be in written form. And so after various iterations of trying to get his thoughts and his stories on paper, I happened to be having lunch with a friend one day, and I told her I was looking for someone to work with Elijah on his book. And she told me that she had a friend who specialized in this. And she introduced me to James Dale. And we had a conversation. It was a fantastic conversation. I introduced him to Elijah, and the rest is history. Many people who knew Elijah and who have read this book say that as they're reading it, they feel like that they hear his voice. I think that that is a testament to Jim's skill, his talent, his listening skills, and his insight. And I just want to say that this book has received two literary award nominations from the NAACP Image Awards. And it has recently been nominated for Audiobook of the Year by the American Publishers Association. And both of those award shows will be in the month of March. So keep your fingers crossed that this book actually wins at least one, if not all, of the categories it's been nominated in. With that, I turn it over to James Dale.
Thank you very much, Maya. And I appreciate the background and the setup, and more than anything, I appreciate the opportunity that you gave me to meet with and work with Elijah over that period of time. And I say that I've been writing books in collaboration for some time, but I say without any hesitation or qualification or caveat at all that of all the projects I've worked on, personally, this book and this project, this particular collaboration, was without question the most meaningful and indelible experience of my writing life by far and away. In session after session, Elijah would tell me stories, and I began to formulate a structure in my mind, a sort of a quilted interweaving of the formative moments of his past, the child of sharecroppers living in segregated neighborhoods and struggling in school, those stories forming the fabric of everything he was able to do in later life, in Washington, in Congress, with presidents, the past informing the present and the future. Very early in our writing sessions, I asked Elijah if there was one story in his past that rose above the rest. With all these wonderful stories, was there one that stood out as being the most formative? And without any hesitation whatsoever, he recounted the following experience, and I'm going to read an excerpt from that story. When I was no more than 11 years old, my life was forever altered. I certainly didn't realize it at the time. I knew something important was happening, but it took a long while before the impact really hit me. We had a neighborhood community playground center where the kids would gather in the summer with a small wading pool and some recreation counselors to watch over us. Our little wading pool was no more than a few feet across and very shallow, maybe up to your knees, filled with kids side by side. You had to take turns a half hour at a time. And after the third group, the water was pretty dirty, but that was the only way we had to get cool on a hot day. One day in late August, a lady came and asked us, kids, how would you like to go to a real swimming pool? One with a diving board, an Olympic-sized pool. Well, we all thought that would be great, but how was that going to happen? Well, she said there was a pool like that only a few blocks away from where we were in Riverside Park, and that we deserved to go there, and that she was going to take us. She said, you can swim to your heart's delight. Those were her words almost 50 years ago, to your heart's delight. Her name was Juanita Jackson Mitchell. To us, she was just this nice lady who was going to take us to a real swimming pool. We didn't realize until later that she was a civil rights pioneer from a family of civil rights pioneers and the first African-American woman to practice law in Maryland. Juanita Jackson Mitchell's mother was the inspirational Dr. Lily Jackson, who descended from a signer of the Declaration of Independence, but still had to attend the segregated colored high school. She rose to president of the Baltimore branch of the NAACP, became an early leader in nonviolent protest, and was known herself as the Mother of Freedom. Her daughter, Juanita, was married to Clarence Mitchell Jr., a national leader in civil rights and lobbyist for the NAACP. And they were the parents of two state senators, Michael and Clarence III. Civil rights was practically the family business. What Mrs. Mitchell did not tell us that day about the nice pool she was taking us to was that it was totally segregated, no Blacks allowed. She and her colleagues at the rec center, Jim Smith and Walter Black, were leading us on an integration march. There we were, a band of little kids walking down the streets of Baltimore from a Black neighborhood to a white neighborhood, only a few blocks from each other, but worlds apart. Day after day, Juanita and Jim and Walter led about 30 of us walking 10 or 15 blocks, while an angry mob, not of other kids, but grown white adults, yelled names at us, told us to go home, and threw rocks and bricks at little kids. One of those rocks struck me in the forehead and caused a scar that I carry to this day. The police watched and the newspapers took pictures and ran stories, but nobody stopped the angry residents and nobody stopped us. We kids would swim at the Riverside Park pool each day and then leave with quote unquote neighbors yelling racial epithets and throwing debris and rocks and bottles at white kids and white kids pushing Black kids in the pool. I call them neighbors ironically. Yes, we all lived within blocks of each other, but they were hardly neighborly. They were the opposite, people trying to keep us out of their neighborhood. Tensions were high. After taking Sunday off, they let us all back on Monday. That day, someone called Walter's associate, Lyle Roberts, a nigger, the hostility escalating. About that time, the Riverside Park citizens, clinging to their segregated white enclave, must have realized that we were all just going to keep coming back, because they stopped coming to their doorways and out into the streets shouting and throwing rocks. Just as Juanita Mitchell promised, we all got to go to a real pool. And as she said, we swam to our heart's delight. Even as little children, we had a sense of victory, victory and fear. We'd gone off to play every day, but we ended up making history. That was in the early 1960s. And old rules and practices and even prejudices began slowly but steadily to change. Baltimore stayed largely segregated for the next 10 years, but it was the beginning, the root of what would evolve into a massive upheaval in social norms, change. For me, that was the beginning of wanting to become somebody who could make things change. I saw that Mitchell and the other people who made integration happen were lawyers. So I wanted to be a lawyer. These lawyers were young men and women who had the courage to walk up the streets, have people yell at them and be unafraid, to have little kids following them, trusting and believing in them, to make change happen. I wasn't sure what a lawyer was, what their job was, but I saw what they could accomplish. Oh my God, what a powerful force that could be. Change. Little Black children getting what only white children had, because we were, after all, just kids, no matter what color, who wanted the same chances in life, the chance to swim in a pool, the chance to go to a good school or live in a nice neighborhood or see a better world. I wanted to be part of that change, and I have endeavored to do so ever since, and I have pursued it ever since. As for progress in achieving change, here's a fitting postscript. 30 years later, a man came up and identified himself as one of those in the angry mob and told me he was sorry. What is the right response to justice acknowledged but so long delayed? I did not applaud his admission, nor did I spurn it. I said, apology accepted. So Elijah told me, as we worked on this, he told me he never forgot the swimming pool incident. It was truly formative. He said he often called upon the memory to fuel his actions in Washington when he conducted hearings on the Trump immigration policies, separating mothers and children, putting them in cages, telling them to go back to where they came from, when Trump launched his Twitter attack on Cummings' beloved hometown as a, quote, disgusting rat and rodent infested mess? When Elijah answered ABC's George Stephanopoulos' question, yes, Trump is a racist, no doubt about it. When Elijah walked the streets of Baltimore to calm his city after the senseless death of young Freddie Gray, at Freddie's funeral, when he asked those watching and listening, did you see him? Did you really see him? You see him in the casket and you see him on the news, but when he walked to school, when he played ball on his neighborhood team, when he sang in the choir, did you see him? Elijah Cummings decried the invisible Black lives so often lost, never really seen. It's stories like this that became the fabric that interwove his life and his mission. And now Maya, his wife and partner, who wrote the last chapter of the book after Elijah's death, will take us, talk to us about that final chapter and about the messages he left us and how he would have felt about most recent events that have unfolded since. Maya.
Thank you, Jim. That event was pivotal for Elijah because it inspired him, of course, to become a lawyer, but it also taught him the power of people, how if you take action, organize action, nonviolent action, and use the levers of our laws and the Constitution, then you can make a transformative difference in the lives of people. And Elijah's ultimate goal in life was to pursue justice and make this country a more perfect union. And so with that, you know, he lent his passions to pursuing his life dream of becoming a lawyer. He became one of the first cohorts of African-American students to integrate Baltimore public schools in his middle school years, went to a prestigious high school here in Baltimore called City College, then went on to graduate Phi Beta Kappa from Howard University, attended the University of Maryland Law School, graduating in 3 years and passing the bar on the first time, then became a Maryland House of Delegates member, rising to become the first ever African-American speaker pro tem before actually becoming a US congressman, becoming a chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and then ultimately rising to become the chair of the Government Oversight and Reform Committee. And so Elijah achieved his dream. I'm going to read a segment from my section of the book, and then I'll bring us up to our current time. After the Democrats regained the majority in the midterms, Elijah was the chairman of the Committee on Oversight and Reform. He was finally in a position to lead investigations and to set the agenda for hearings. But he was sober about the realities of the threats he and his committee would face from the Trump administration and congressional Republicans. Despite his pain, he threw himself into his work. Then in late summer, just before his speech at the National Press Club, he took yet another bad turn and was readmitted to Johns Hopkins. The underlying suspicion was that his cancer had come back. Elijah was weaker than I'd seen him in years. A day before he was to give the speech, I asked if he still intended to do it. He said, Maya, I'll be there if I have to crawl. Elijah was so drained that when his aides maneuvered him to the podium, pale and unsteady, I thought he might drop. Then he looked at the crowd, 4 or 5 times the size of what had been expected. Before his investigations into the administration, before the shootings in Dayton and El Paso, and before Trump's Twitter attack on Baltimore and Elijah, he looked at the crowd and you could see him become energized. He exhorted the audience to listen and, more importantly, to take action. He was passionate as only Elijah Cummings could be. The gathering of usually callous Washington media cheered and gave him a standing ovation. Exhausted and barely able to keep going, he went straight back to the hospital. During the next few weeks, he managed to continue vital work. He was on the phone with Nancy Pelosi, Adam Schiff, Jerry Nadler, and his staff. He read testimony. He reviewed the impeachment updates. He signed subpoenas. So many times I said, "Elijah, that's enough for today." "Okay, I'll stop soon," he'd say. Doctors at Hopkins and NIH monitored his cancer. It was obviously recurring. The question was, could they do anything to slow it down or limit it? We all did everything we could. There became, I think the best word is, an inevitability to it. He knew, and I suspected, we were coming to the end. It was coming as if you could see it like a train approaching in the distance, when you're not sure how far away it is, but you know it's steadily coming towards you. That's when he began to talk differently. He would say he was tired, no matter how much rest he got, just tired all the time. He complained of constant pain. It was clearly physical, but it was also emotional and spiritual. The inner Elijah was burning out. We talked about the past, what Elijah had done, and about the future and all that remained to be done. But we did not use the word death. We just knew. As if sped by his passing, events moved even faster in the days just after Elijah's death. On December 18th, 2019, Speaker Nancy Pelosi banged the gavel and announced that the House of Representatives voted 230 to 197 strictly along party lines to impeach President Donald J. Trump, the third president in the history of the United States to face impeachment charges. That evening, during her press conference, she spoke about Elijah. She honored him as a key force in the inquiry, calling him our North Star. And she quoted him, "When the history books are written about this tumultuous era, I want them to show that I was among those in the House of Representatives who stood up to lawlessness and tyranny." She added, he also said somewhat presciently, "When we're dancing with angels, the question will be, what did you do to make sure we kept our democracy intact?" We did all we could, Elijah. We passed the two articles of impeachment. The president is impeached. As I often told people in the days after his death, Elijah's death wasn't just my loss. It was our loss as a nation. And we all have the responsibility to move his legacy forward, because we know that with every transgression, every disregard for the Constitution, every attempt to act above the law, every denial of truth, our democracy is endangered. That's why in the months and years ahead, we must continue to hear Elijah's voice. We're better than this. We're better than this. Yes, we are. We must be. Indeed, Elijah's words, his deed, and legacy were prescient, perhaps more so than any of us would have wished. Since his passing, we've lived through the historical moments, moments they'll be talking about 200 years from now. From the first impeachment charges to the partisan acquittal, to the COVID pandemic and the botched response by the Trump administration, Elijah would not have been surprised at their COVID response or lack thereof. To the ugly presidential campaign, to the election, mercifully, of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, to the claims of a stolen election by Trump and his loyalists, to the unfounded, outrageous lawsuits claiming voter fraud that Trump continuously filed, to the dismissal of all of those suits, to state elected officials, Republicans, denying the president's election lies, particularly in Georgia and some other places, to even stalwarts like Bill Barr and Chris Christie rejecting the fraud claims, to the complicity, the utter complicity and cowardice of over 100 members of the US Congress in their effort to overturn the Electoral College votes for President Biden and Vice President Harris, to Trump turning on his own Vice President Pence, to the president himself inciting a violent insurrection at the US Capitol. And then finally, of course, to the second impeachment, the only time that it's ever occurred in the history of this country, this time with bipartisan support. What would have Elijah thought? A lot of people have asked me, what would he have done? Has his worst fears come to pass? He tells us in the book what he thought. He said, quote, "Democracy literally means a government run by the people. People don't always agree, but to get anywhere, especially in the polarizing arena of politics, we have to find common ground, something to build trust and respect on. You also have to teach people that you have boundaries, bottom lines, things you will not do, behaviors you will not put up with, places you will not go. As in a democracy, having our own checks and balances teaches our friends as well as our leaders what we will and will not accept." Elijah would have found Donald J. Trump's incitement of the mob on January 6th an unacceptable bottom line. He would have begged the US Senate to not just support the impeachment of the House, but to convict Donald Trump. And he would have been disappointed that they did not do so. Elijah has been bipartisan in his approach since before Congress, working in the Maryland House of Delegates and then coming to Congress. He was known for having friends on both sides of the aisle. He tried to actually approach Donald Trump with integrity and in good faith. And instead, all he got was lies and bad faith in return. And I would argue that that's the same thing that the country has received. And so, you know, the fact of the matter is that we have a democracy. And as Elijah said, we must protect and defend it or risk losing it. And at that, I would like to open it up for a dialogue.
Great.
Thank you so much. And thank you for sharing that very personal story from your chapters. I'm sure that is not easy to read through every time, but thank you for that. So for folks that are in the audience, we're happy to take your questions now and go ahead and put them in the Q&A at the bottom of your screen. And maybe I'll ask one just to get us going. If the two of you might be willing to talk a tiny bit more about some of the actual process of the collaboration, your collaboration, Jim, with Elijah Cummings, and then maybe how you came in to the whole writing process, Maya. If you could talk a little bit more about the nuts and bolts of that, I think people would be interested. It's maybe sure. Unusual.
Yeah, it was unusual, and as Maya said at the very opening, she really was the matchmaker here. She brought me to Elijah, and she, I didn't know that they had been, I knew just a little bit, they'd been working on it previously, but not to their satisfaction. We had some early meetings that I said were kind of like, they were kind of like early dates, you know, to see if we liked each other, see if we'd hit it off, and to see if it, because really it was so dependent upon him opening up to us to, at the beginning, I was a stranger. It's not an easy thing to do if you put yourself in that position. You imagine, here's this person, you met him, you know, a few minutes ago, but Elijah was a very fast study of people, I learned later. And I am always reminded that our first meeting was scheduled for a half hour. And he kept me there 3 hours and told me story after story. And I became completely hooked on the idea at that point. Originally, it was just sort of feeling each other out. And by the time that was over with, I thought, I have to write this book if he'll let me. And once we got going and once we had that rapport established, we would meet a couple times a week. And in between we had, I don't even know how many phone conversations. I recorded him. He would talk again, almost always it would be, "Jim, I've got 15 or 20 minutes. And then 45 minutes or an hour or 2 hours later, he'd say, "I think I better go." I went to both of his offices, his office in Baltimore, his office in Washington. I rode back and forth with him to the Capitol, to and from work. And one of the things I also learned early on is that he texted. And I also learned that he kept long hours. You know, as Maya said, she would say to him, enough for today. That was always the case. When he was very, very sick, he was doing it. But throughout the entire relationship, I joked about it. I would joke with him about it. Say, I got a text from you, you know, at 1:30 in the morning. What were you doing? And he'd say, what was I doing? I was working. And, or I'd send him a text and he would see it and he'd answer it. And I didn't expect it at that time. And he was driven by his work. He was driven by his mission. Once he got into writing this book, there was sort of no stopping him. And he said on more than one occasion, I'm in a hurry. I'm in a hurry to do this. And that turned out to be true on two levels. He was anxious, once having committed to this book, he was anxious to get that message out there. That's the kind of driven, as he used to say, be effective and efficient. That's the kind of person he was. But underlying all that, he was in a hurry because I didn't know for quite some time, and then later did as we worked together, how sick he was. It wasn't apparent right away. And he worked and worked and worked, so you wouldn't know it. I knew that he had a great deal of difficulty walking, but I didn't know that his actual life was in danger and was being eaten away at, quite literally. I didn't know the history until he finally revealed it to me. He was in a hurry because he was in a race with time. And we were very lucky, I guess, to get his story in front of people. And as the process went on, from time to time, I would talk to Maya, and she would often say to me, just go back and talk to Elijah some more. It was like she was in a hurry. You know, everybody, it was driving toward that end. And we didn't know when it was going to come, and we didn't think it would come quite as soon as it did, but we knew we had to hurry.
Thank you. Thanks for that. We have a question here from the audience that I will pop up, and it's actually from Maya. So if you want to join us again, Maya. This is from Kathy. Kathy says, it seems clear that much of the division in the country is based in hatred, anger, and fear, but I wonder what your husband's take was on people who clearly have strong friendships but sometimes struggle to be good allies. I'm thinking specifically of Mark Meadows, but I think it applies to many. Also, thank you so much for sharing part of your life with us.
Yeah, no, thank you for that question. For some of us, it's a hard concept to even fathom, right? That, you know, somebody that holds views that are so opposite of your own, that you could actually come to respect on the level of your common humanity and even develop a friendship with, right? But Elijah had this amazing ability, and I guess we call it compartmentalize. You know, how we teach our children that, you know, their actions and their words are not necessarily them. They're things that they might say or do, but, you know, that it's not who they are necessarily. And so for Elijah, you know, he treated people as human beings. He tried to get to know them on the basis of, you know, who they were at heart, who their families were, and what their passions were, and what their hobbies were. And yes, you know, when they came into the hearing room, they would be on the polar opposite side of an issue. But, you know, when they were in the gym or in the personal office, and by the way, Mark Meadows used to come to Elijah's office after hours and shoot the breeze with him in his office. You know, it was a different story. Now, you know, a lot of people, especially Republicans, I should say, don't trust Mark Meadows. And I've read stories that, you know, that they've questioned his motives. But Elijah felt like, why put energy into that? You know, if, and I do believe that, and I do know, actually, not believe, that Mark Meadows would actually pass, you know, notes, basically messages back and forth between key parts to find out, you know, where Republicans stood on X, Y issue, or where the president stood on this issue. So it was also a backdoor channel for communications to understand where Republicans were and to help Elijah position his policy and his politics correctly. So, you know, it was a weird relationship, but, you know, Elijah got to know many Republicans, and oftentimes it was a result of, you know, them actually forming a bond and friendship in the House gym, which was downstairs in the basement of the Rayburn building.
That's great. Can you tell us a little bit about his workout?
You know, it's funny because Elijah wasn't playing basketball. He used to go to the House gym to actually get rest from chemotherapy. They have little sleeping pods down there, and Elijah would go get rest. Sometimes he would go get in the sauna if he felt like it. If he had to stay overnight, he would sleep in the pod down there. And so the other people may have been working out. Elijah was resting.
That's important. Important as well. Yeah. So we have another question here. And I'm curious what I'm interested to hear from both of you, your perspective on this. If you were going to select, you know, a pivotal moment in his career, in his political career, I'd be interested to hear what you think of that moment and why that would be pivotal. And I'm wondering if the two of you might have different answers, perhaps.
We might. Well, that's very different than pivotal moments in childhood and growing up, because I think there were a few of those moments that he did identify. I don't know, Maya, this is a tough one for in his career. You may know this certainly better, because I always say that, you know, he went off to work every day, and then at night you could dissect the day and deconstruct it. I do think, based on what I learned from him, and again, I think Maya may have much more light to shed on this, but he did a remarkable thing by, first of all, deciding to attend the inauguration of Trump and then deciding to meet with him. He was asked to meet with him one-on-one. It wasn't quite one-on-one, but at a very small meeting, but basically the two of them and there, a couple of people surrounding them. And at a time when people already didn't trust this guy, they already said, first of all, his views are 180 degrees from Elijah's, from almost every Democrat, but Elijah felt that maybe, it sort of relates back to what Maya's previous comment about reaching across, maybe two human beings, two guys, he said to me, like two guys on the street could meet and talk. Maybe they could connect. Not that they're going to come to a great epiphany and say, oh my God, you know what? We're actually coming in from the same place. They're not, but maybe they could find a way to connect and find some areas where there might be something they could do. And actually Elijah thought on the very specific subject of prescription drug costs, which Trump had supposedly railed against at some points during his campaign. Maybe there was something they could do. And Trump gave him a little bit of a sense that maybe there was, and then completely flipped on him, told a lie about the meeting, misrepresented what Elijah said, claimed that Elijah said he was going to be a great president, absolutely destroyed that whatever shred of communication existed. And I think if he held out any hope prior to that, that maybe there was a way to work with him, I think it, from that moment on, it was watch your back. Not just your own back, our back, the country's back. That's the closest I could come to finding a moment, but there probably are many.
Yeah, that's right. I think that was a pivotal moment in his later career. I think that his early Capitol Hill career, I would say that when he became the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus, and towards the end of that, I think right upon the end of that, the Hurricane Katrina happened. And so there was a lot of concern because, as some of you might recall, the George W. Bush administration was very slow out of the gate in terms of responding to that. There were people that were obviously suffering and dying in New Orleans. People were in the Astrodome, in their own filth. They didn't have water, they didn't have food. Elijah flew down, gathered a few of his Congressional Black Caucus members and flew down to New Orleans to bring attention to the matter. I'll never forget that there was a bank of cameras and he landed and they did a press conference. And Elijah used a line that I've only seen twice. The first time he used it was there in New Orleans, where he said, and he was directly addressing the cameras and directly addressing George W. Bush. And he said, "God would not be pleased at this poor response." And I swear to God, after Elijah got out there and said that, those words ricocheted around the country, and it's like it lit a fire under the George W. Bush administration. And, you know, they started moving at an accelerated rate to actually bring relief to the people of New Orleans. I think that moment, that particular moment, showed Elijah the power, I think, of his voice. And it certainly captured the attention of the nation. The words, "God would not be pleased," he said, his voice carried so much weight, had a lot of gravitas, he did. But those words, and the other time that he uttered it, to my knowledge, was when the kids were being ripped apart from their families at the southern border. Right. And he said in a hearing, "God would not be pleased." And so, you know, Elijah would have been the first to tell you that he was not a prophet like the Elijah in the Bible. And yes, both of his parents were preachers, and he was raised in a very religious household, and he was a man of faith. But, you know, there was something about both of those moments where he called to a higher power and sought to move a nation, and did.
That definitely sounds pivotal, right? For both him and for the country. I'd love to bring Jasmine from Langston back on. She actually has a question for you as well. So we'll invite her to join us back on stage here.
Thank you. Hi, Jasmine. Hey, my question is actually for you as well, Maya. And I just have to say before I ask my question too, you know, hearing your voice and watching you as you read the words that you wrote, you know, as the final chapter in this book, it's one thing, and I haven't read the book yet, but it's one thing to read something and you kind of read it in your own mind and you translate it however you translate it when you're reading, but to hear your voice and to see you as you're reading and sharing his final thoughts and final words, really, I don't know, I'll just say it affected me. It rocks you to just, you know, to hear it in that way. So thank you for sharing. I echo, I think, what another commenter said, just thank you for sharing, because I can't imagine, no matter how many times you do this, that it's an easy thing to do. So thank you. And one of the things I want to ask is just, you know, I recall after Congressman Elijah Cummings passed, that he was the first African-American to lie in state. And you know, my opinion on first is a whole other thing, because I can't believe we're still facing first in this day and age. But you know, when I think about that, and at the time that we were in, with the administration that we were in, there's something about that just feels even more impactful about the legacy that he leaves behind. And I guess I just wonder, from your perspective and maybe from other family members' perspective, like, what did that moment mean to you after after he had passed away, and he was honored in such a way that no other African-American had been honored, African-American lawmaker had been honored like that before. What did that mean to you and to your family?
Yeah, thank you for the question. It meant the world to us because he had been so disrespected in the days before his death. Just imagine a sitting president of the United States calling you out, saying that you're a poor excuse for a leader, saying that, you know, your city is filthy and no human being would want to live there, saying that your constituents, intimating that your constituents were subhuman. You know, comparing them to rats and rodents, you know, it hurt Elijah to his core. And he was already in a weakened health state. And he said, and he said in the book, that President Trump's words would kill him. And so, you know, I've got to tell you that my state of mind upon his death, I was angry. I felt like we were in a battle and that I could have been wearing combat boots and fatigues. And that, you know, I just wanted to kick butt and take names. And Donald Trump's was one that I wanted to take and do something with. So, you know, we really pushed to get him special recognition, given his huge sacrifices that he made for that Congress and for this country. And, you know, and you should know that Donald Trump is not just a mean man. He's not just a cruel man. He is an evil man. And whenever he goes after you, he actually, it's the nod to all of his minions out there to actually pile on. And so Elijah was getting death threats. There were all kinds of nastiness, negative things that were happening that, you know, you can't even imagine. And so, you know, when he finally got his just due in terms of lying in state, it felt as if he were being honored in a unique way that made it maybe worth it. Maybe it was worth it. And he also had a room. He's the first African-American legislator to ever have a room anywhere in the US Capitol complex named after him. So the Oversight and Reform Hearing Room was named after him. And so I'm proud of that.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I honor you and I thank you because I know this is difficult, but for the rest of us, I appreciate what you're doing to maintain his legacy and everything that he lived for and everything that he fought for. He's so important to our history, American history. That's what I mean when I say our history. And as difficult as it clearly is, the strength that you exhibit by doing this as often as I'm sure you're doing this, I thank you and I appreciate you for that because it's very important. So thank you so much.
Thank you for that question, Jasmine. And thank you, Maya, for that response. I think we're getting close to the end of our time here, but you know, both of you actually mentioned the word legacy. And so it would be wonderful to talk a little bit about Elijah's legacy. And I know, Maya, you were telling me earlier that you were speaking with the school. And so do you want to talk a little bit about the work that you're doing now and maybe that message that you're sharing with those kids and maybe with us?
So the fantastic work that Jim and Elijah did with this book is a part of his legacy. We've got two picture books that are coming out. We've got a young readers edition for middle schoolers is coming out. Jim and I are working on a documentary that we pray will be coming out in another year or so. And of course, you know, you've got the Elijah Cummings Youth Program. There is a school here in town called the Green Street Academy that just named an Elijah E. Cummings Innovation Center after Elijah. There's another school that's naming an educational center of excellence for him. So, you know, and of course, you know, there's the University of Maryland Law School has created a fellowship in his name. There are just a lot of things that are happening to actually memorialize Elijah and actually leave a legacy for him, all of which we're very proud of.
The funeral was the most amazing collection of people paying tribute that you could possibly imagine in one place, both Hillary and Bill Clinton and Joe Biden and Elizabeth Warren, and I mean, one after another after another. And of course, Barack Obama, who said something at the funeral that stuck with so many of us. It was a big picture of Elijah, and it said, "The Honorable Elijah E. Cummings." And Barack Obama said, "I want to say something about this, him being the Honorable Elijah Cummings." He said, "That's what you call him. That was his formal, that's a title you earn when you're serving at this level." He said, "But Elijah Cummings was honorable long before he had that title." And that was, I thought, the most cogent summation of a man's life.
That's beautiful. Well, I think we're coming to the end of our time here. And so I just want to thank both of you for joining us tonight. It's been wonderful to get a glimpse into his life. And I'm sure the book has a lot of additional stories about his impact and maybe some juicy details about some of the behind the scenes political stuff. So thank you so much for writing the book and for bringing his story to us and sharing that with us. I wanted to let folks know that for those of you who are interested in reading or Better Than This, it's available in print or digital formats through the library. And our website is spl.org. And I actually went ahead and put the direct link to the books in the chat there. You can also find copies at Estelita's Library, an amazing social justice oriented bookshop here in Seattle. And you can order the book through their website, estelitaslibrary.com. And I put that link in the chat as well. So thank you both for being here tonight. We're so appreciative. And you know, it's inspiring to hear about his life and his work. Thanks to our partners at Langston. And we're also grateful to our sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times. And actually, I'm just remembering, Jasmine, you mentioned there might be another event that you wanted to let folks know about. Do you want to?
Sure. I don't want to overshadow this evening, but we do have a local poet and author named Chelsea Richardson, who is releasing her book of poetry called All Water Has Perfect Memory. And we're launching that on Saturday at noon. So if you go to langstonseattle.org, you can find more information about how to participate in that and also just subscribe to our newsletter and become a family member of Langston so that you can continue to stay tuned into events like this and other events that are all focused on cultivating Black brilliance.
Excellent.
Thank you, Stesha and Seattle Public Library. Oh, thanks. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings. This has been an amazing night.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much. We appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah. Good night, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us.
Good night. Take care.
Thank you.